There's a show that's existed for many years. It's free to watch online. It's had millions upon millions of viewers worldwide who have seen it and enjoyed it. And it is actually one of the greatest TV shows ever. This TV show is Big Mouth. Oh, God, no. It's actually Futurama. Yeah. So after completely ripping off one of my favorite creators, Emp Lemon, and his intro from his neutral response video, I'm back for the second and final part of my series on the two Futurama episodes that I could easily watch anytime, anywhere. They're also a couple of my favorite ones in the whole series. Last time, I talked about the why of Fry, and when it comes to the why of Fry, there's another unique aspect of it which I forgot to mention in part one of this two-part Sans movie special. In the original 1999 airing of the Futurama pilot on Fox, Nibbler's shadow can be seen when Fry falls into the freezer tube. Nibbler pushes him, as he saw from the Why of Fry episode. This has to be the greatest foreshadowing ever put in a TV show. The writers knew they would make the episode which turned out to be the Why of Fry one day, but they didn't know what it would be about. All they knew was that it'd have something to do with Nibbler being there when Fry was first frozen. So this is just absolute awesomeness for a Futurama nerd like myself to see this kind of foreshadowing so many years before the Why of Fry was made. And while this is an absolute classic episode, which is so brilliant to look back on, it isn't actually my favorite Futurama episode to sit back and watch. It's a close second though. No, that honor goes to today's topic, which you've already seen in the title, Roswell That Ends Well. This episode is so important in the series that it ties into a bunch of the information on Fry, and also more importantly how he exists. It also directly ties into the why of Fry, as you can see here.
It's a genetic abnormality which resulted when you went back in time and—
Okay, that's one hint too many. I need to go straight into talking about this episode. Also, just like last time, there's spoilers to the entire episode, so it's probably best you see the episode before watching my video for both episodes I've reviewed, but you still watch, you know, my video after. I mean, you know, if you want to. Roswell That Ends Well begins with the Planet Express crew going on a space outing to witness a supernova of a star in the universe. Everyone is gearing up to see it, but Bender decides the moment needs popcorn, so he asks Fry to get it for him, and he makes it in a microwave. Of course, the supernova happens, and there's a reaction between the blue microwaves and the red supernova waves. I don't understand how to explain the science of this. This is a cartoon after all, but it did have multiple people with PhDs actually making this. Sorry about me minding my P's in the microphone. So naturally, this rips the Planet Express ship through the space-time continuum, and they go back roughly 1,055 odd years into the past.
Ooh, my popcorn's done.
They crash land on Earth because the ship has no navigation correlation to the Earth to help it be brought back into the Earth's atmosphere. I'm just guessing that's why they crash landed, it seems like it from the show. Bender is thrusted out of the ship's front window because he didn't wear a seatbelt, and Zoidberg is made to pick up the debris of Bender's body. Naturally, if you know the Roswell situation in 1947 very vaguely, you're already starting to piece two and two together as a viewer, but the situation becomes very clear when the US Army man says this.
As you can see, 1947 is going to be an eventful year for the town of Roswell, New Mexico.
Oh my god, they are the Roswell aliens. Oh, wow. And Bender was the spaceship. Oh, shit. It's actually pretty cool. So yeah, they are writing history as they know it, but in their eyes, they are tampering with it. This becomes all the more interesting and disgusting as the episode rolls on, trust me. So after the government people take Bender's body parts and also Zoidberg, Fry dresses in army clothes and finds his grandfather, Enos. Enos!
Enos!
And then there's a Back to the Future reference. Fry literally almost kills his grandfather before the government and the army higher-ups run tests on Zoidberg.
A buffet? Oh, if only I had my wallet with me.
It's free.
Oh!
Get me the president.
Meanwhile, Leela and Farnsworth pose as regular people from the 1950s as Leela finds out what sort of derogatory insults were hurled around back then towards women.
Stand down here, a foot soaking tub. Since as a woman, you'll be standing in front of it all day. You know, you really don't cook enough roast, Leela. Oh, women.
They also try and order 3,000's food from a 1940s cafe menu.
Two mutton pills and a stein of mead.
I'll just have a small injection of Femislim.
Two chili dogs coming up.
At that same cafe earlier, Fry gets to know his grandfather more.
But did you ever get the feeling you're only going with girls because you're supposed to?
What?! Don't ever, ever say or think that again!
But then he continues being paranoid that his grandfather will die and that he will cease to exist. So he drives him to a house in the middle of nowhere to attempt to keep him safe. And yeah, great safe house. It's a military testing range.
Well, I killed my grandfather.
What?
So there's no chance of him coming back as a zombie.
I'm not worried about that.
Then you're a braver woman than I.
You remind me of Venus.
Fry comforts his grandma some more and then walks him home. Meanwhile, Zoidberg is interviewed by President Truman and then Truman decides to perform an autopsy on him. Back at the family Fry house, Fry then gets with his grandma after walking her home. The rest of the Planet Express crew find him the next morning.
Oh my god!
Then a stunning revelation of incestual proportions comes about.
It's impossible! I mean, if she's my grandmother, who's my grandfather?
Isn't it obvious? You are! Start the ship, Leela. Let's just steal the damn radar dish and get back to our own time.
But won't that change history?
Oh, a lesson in not changing history from Mr. I'm my own grandpa.
Hey! I'm my own grandpa!
Farnsworth then says,
let's get the hell out of here already. Screw history.
And they decide to hightail it out of Roswell. On the way, they save Zoidberg when the government people are finally removing body parts he actually needs after a long process of Zoidberg being pretty nonchalant with what they're doing to him.
Heart.
Take, I've got four of them.
Stomach contents, one deviled egg.
Deviled egg?
The same deviled egg.
So they rescue Zoidberg, the professor takes Bender's body parts that were turned into a spaceship, and then the commanding officer is interrupted during his lunch.
Enos!
He's dead! Sorry!
On the way out of 1947, Bender sends a message to that era.
1947 can kiss my shiny metal!
They can't go back to get him because the supernova time hole is closing up and, well, you guessed it, they'll be stuck in 1947 if they don't enter it. So they barely leave 1947 to escape to the present, leaving Bender stuck in the past. But upon their return, Fry realizes something.
He must be so lonely right now, trapped 1,000 years in the past. Hey, wait a second.
So after around 1,055 years stuck in the ground, Bender is unearthed without anyone finding him in that time before them.
Stupid jerk!
He's alive! Bender, what was it like lying in that hole for 1,000 years?
I was enjoying it until you guys showed up.
And if history doesn't care that our degenerate friend Fry is his own grandfather, then who are we to judge?
Amen.
The Planet Express crew then walk into the sunset to end my favorite episode of Futurama. Well, the most watchable episode of the show at least. I love this story and the overall hijinks of this episode so much that I wish this episode was turned into 90 minutes to add to the other 4 Futurama movie length episodes. It is just so enjoyable to sit back and watch. And I mean, a story with incest, how can you go wrong there? Oh god, that's mess. I think it's the time travel aspect that The Why of Fry and Roswell That Ends Well has, which ultimately makes these episodes my favorite ones to sit back and watch from Futurama. My favorite movie is Back to the Future, so it makes sense. I love time travel in TV shows and movies. Futurama really is one of those special shows, and I want to thank you guys for joining me in this 2-part series on the 2 episodes from the show that I just never get tired of watching. And who knows, maybe I'll revisit this show again one day on my channel. Maybe. Or maybe not. But hell yeah! Futurama rules!